So I found myself, the department is this office complex that was one of the first kind of international standing in big office complexes, hotel office complexes in Shanghai. And I found myself, I moved there, that's where my office was located, and I found myself quite by accident there at a really interesting historical moment. I have had spent... I had spent early years of my career in Africa as a freelancer for the Washington Post and various other people, and then I had been hired by the New York Times and had worked in a few other places, parts of the world for the Times, and then went back to Africa for the New York Times. And so by the time I got to Shanghai, I had worked in Africa twice, and I arrived in Africa, I'm sorry, in China in 2003 at the Portman, and I'm literally looking out the window at the entrance to this big complex and noticing, quite unprepared for this, that the frequency of African delegations arriving in that hotel was steadily and rapidly increasing, from a trickle in 2003 to a flood by, say, 2005. And because I had worked in Africa so much, I was naturally sort of sensitive to the question of what did this represent, and I began to poke around. And at this point, I can't say that I really was the person who discovered, you know, China, Africa as a topic. That would be a bit much. But I think not a whole lot of people were paying a great amount of attention to this at the time. And so I pursued the question as best I could, and I come to sort of get a glimmer of the fact of a really booming set of relationships that was just getting off the ground. And so these were heads of state delegations who were coming to Shanghai, typically either on their way to Beijing or on their way out of Beijing. And it was kind of the R&R or shopping or sightseeing part of their official trips. And I began talking with people in some of these delegations, and I began talking with people in the Chinese policy world, and I began asking others as well about what this all represented. And so by 2005, I proposed a series to the New York Times, having satisfied myself that this was really important, and I went off and I did a three-country series, three-part series, about what I'm going to call a relationship, the China-Africa relationship, with the advisor that this is really not an accurate way of speaking of what has happened. We have a continent of 54 countries and a country called China, and this is really a set of relationships, but it becomes cumbersome to say that every time, and so people say China-Africa as if it was just one thing, and it really isn't. Anyway, I went to the continent to do a three-part series for the Times. I traveled in for that project. I traveled to Ethiopia, Chad, and Malawi. And it was what I did was what many people had just begun to do and then subsequently continue to do, and some people still continue to do, which is write what we in journalism call a kind of 30,000-foot view of the situation. So here you have China over here, and here you have Africa over here, and there's all of this activity now linking them up. What does this all mean? And asking in a very big picture sense, you know, that question and trying to answer it as best I could. I left the Times in 2008 and to join the faculty at Columbia Journalism School, and very shortly afterwards, Atlantic Magazine. So by this time, now lots of people are writing on China, Africa. And Columbia Journalism School, I'm sorry, Atlantic Magazine asked me to write on the topic, and I proposed a trip, and I did another trip to Africa that covered three countries, and this was for Atlantic, Tanzania, Zambia, and Congo. And I traveled overland via the Tazara Railway from Dar es Salaam, the economic capital of Tanzania, all the way to the terminus, which is kind of, Zambia is this kind of barbell, bent barbell-shaped country. It's sort of in the crux of the barbell, right at the sort of junction of the Africa, sort of Africa's major copper-producing area. I get off and I travel by road into Congo. I stopped in various places, but at the end of the railway, I went by car into Congo. And so I produced again a large magazine piece and asking lots of big picture questions about what does this mean, what are China's ambitions, what does it mean for Africa, et cetera, et cetera. When I returned from that trip, I was asked subsequently, I mean, this is almost, I'm describing what may sound like, what actually is more than may sound like, is actually a series of accidents. So starting from looking out my window in the driveway of the Portman to having the Atlantic now approach me to ask me to write about this again. Now I write the Atlantic piece and a book publishers approach me. And so I wasn't really seeking to write about this anymore. But by this point, it's a pretty popular topic. And I began to think, so what more can I really say on this theme that gets away from 30,000 feet and adds value to the picture? And I thought back about my reporting experiences for The Times in 2006 and for Atlantic in end of 2008, early 2009. And the thing that really stood out to me is something that I mentioned just a little bit in the Times series. I mentioned a bit more in the Atlantic piece, but it was never really the focus. It was not really the focus of what I did for them. And that is the movement of human beings involved in this interaction, which had really taken off. I didn't have a scientific measurement of this, of course, but anecdotally, between 2006 and 2008, granted going to three different countries in each trip, the scale of human presence was markedly different, in my view. By the time I get to Congo in early 2009, I mean, there were Chinese people. I mean, it's hard to exaggerate. So in a city like Lubumbashi, there were Chinese people on every street corner. You know, I'd spent a lot of time in Lubumbashi in the mid-1990s covering a war in Congo. And I don't recall seeing any Chinese people at all in the entire Congo. So that's between mid-90s now and 2009, of course. That's a pretty big gap. So I began to think that trying to inspect these relationships, I'll call it because it's less awkward for convenience, this relationship in human terms was probably a good thing to do. And so I proposed to the book publisher that I write that story, and I went off and I traveled through 17 African countries and three trips over the course of a year, cumulatively about a year on the ground. And I basically spent time with Chinese people in their own newcomers, in their own environments, sometimes staying in their homes or on their farms, traveling with them about the countries that they lived in, going to their businesses and watching the way they work and hearing about their lives and the issues that they encounter in all different dimensions. I guess because I don't want to recount the book to you in blow fashion. I guess in terms of my reporting, there's a picture that I have to paint for you that's very important, and that is the mechanism of movement of these peoples, these Chinese newcomers. And I'll try to do that in the space of just a few minutes. And then I want to talk about, to repeat the word mechanism, the historical mechanisms that set in place this entire process, which is what really interests me at this phase, having done this book. I'm presently working on other things, but the theme that I'll end with is, as relates to China-Africa, is what really preoccupies me at this moment. So in the mid-1990s, Jiang Zemin, who was the leader of China at the time, announces a policy called going out. And as a result of a series of high-level policy deliberations, the Chinese leadership decides that Africa should be a priority for it. As with a lot of policy pronunciations in China, a way of enforcement, if you will, or a way of inducing various actors in China to comply with new policies is to set the provinces in competition with each other and to grade the leaders of the provinces on the basis of how well they've complied with the spirit of whatever the new policies are. And so going out was a policy that very much acted in this way. The provinces were told, look, you know, we're making this priority of sending, you know, having businesses go to Africa and increasing Chinese trade and investment with Africa, et cetera. So you figure it out at your level, the provincial level, how to make this happen. And the Chinese provinces at that time had one You know, different provinces have different economies, but one thing that's very common among the Chinese provinces is that they, being in the midst of an incredible infrastructure boom that has basically transformed the landscape in China in a pretty short period of time, they all had these infrastructure companies that had, you know, vast business in China and were looking to expand internationally. And so infrastructure becomes the major mechanism for engaging Africa, and the province's state-owned companies that are, in effect, provincial companies are competing for business in Africa. And so in terms of the movement of peoples, this is the first thing that happens. Central government sets in place various mechanisms for financing of contract business, for infrastructure creation through state policies, what are called policy banks. Provincial companies go off and they prospect for business in Africa, and they begin winning contracts very quickly, starting in the mid-1990s. And one success leads to another. And so people are now, provincial companies, you know, from Henan or from Hubei or from Hebei or from wherever, they're competing now to get into the mix of this, what quickly became a pretty lucrative business that Chinese companies had huge competitive advantages with, because they had such capacity in infrastructure building at home already. Plus, they had various kinds of state financing that made it, facilitated things greatly for them. So they begin landing these contracts, and I mentioned Henan. And so Henan is the province that begins to land business in Senegal for some reason. And the pattern that I'm going to describe to you is a very common one. They get a project to build a stadium in Senegal, a Henan construction company. They send, and I'm making up this number, but let's imagine they send 500 workers on a contract for 2 years to build a stadium. And at the end of those two years, 1-5% of the workers decide, on the basis of whatever contact with daily African life they had managed to have, hey, it's not so bad here. We're talking about, you know, ordinary workers, what are known in American work jargon, tradespeople, tradesmen, basically electricians, bricklayers, you know, plumbers, etc. These are people who had very little prior knowledge of the African environment, typically speaking. And so, and what they would have known generally would have been rank stereotype. It's dangerous in Africa. There's disease in Africa. It's really hot in Africa. You know, just you can multiply the stereotypes. And so they arrive in Senegal, and I don't know if any of you have been to Senegal, but Senegal is actually a pretty nice place. You know, the weather is very nice, and the food's really nice, and the people are pretty friendly, and there's no lions chasing you in the street, and, you know, wow, this isn't what I imagined at all. 1-5% of the people decide, well, you know, my contract's up. There's no reason I have to go home. I can stay here. I can try to do something here on my own. I can use whatever, you know, typically these workers have their salaries banked back in China. And so while they're on contract, they're living in a compound and they're fed and taken care of. And so they've got this accumulated saving that they have not been spending money in the local economy that's sitting back in China. And, you know, some of them begin to say, well, if I tap my savings, instead of going home and living off of it or trying to do something there, I can use that money and start a business here. And so this was the first wave of this human movement, and a very common example of the kind of people profile of the kind of people that I describe in my book. So you multiply this by 54 countries. I mean, gradually China begins to develop this kind of business across the African landscape. And different, so even today, most of the Chinese people in Senegal are from Henan, because the early companies that got this business, by the way, so it was a stadium contract in the beginning, and you know, the Chinese contractor gets to bring in their capital equipment through a deal with the government that's part of the contract. Essentially, they pay no duty or very low duty or whatever on the cranes and various other kinds of equipment that they bring in. And very often, at the end of the contract, the company has, having brought all this heavy equipment in, then stays behind and tries to negotiate further contracts by this time. So now the costs are really low. They've amortized the initial cost of all the contracts, of all the construction material and all of that, and it's sitting there. And so they have an incredible competitive basis to bid for new contract. And so this becomes a continuous pipeline. Everything now built by Chinese people in Senegal, not everything, but for the most part, is built by Henan construction companies. And so all of the Chinese people, I'm repeating my error, almost all of the Chinese people in Senegal come from Henan. And so that's the first wave. And you can find this pattern in lots of different places where province X, Y, or Z got the early start in country ABC, and the population of Chinese people in that country remains predominantly people from that province for this reason. The second factor in terms of the population movement is what I call the emulation factor. And it involves a sort of a piece of human nature that tickles me, if I'm correct in terms of the way I understand it. So you're an ordinary person. I think this applies probably to all of us too, right? But you're a tradesperson, right? You're a bricklayer or an electrician or a plumber or whatever. You decide to go to Africa on some contract, and your neighbors all think you're crazy. You know, there's lions in the street, it's bloody hot in Africa, the people are unfriendly, it's dangerous. You go to Africa, you discover it's none of those things. You begin to do well, and the neighbor, you know, social media is pretty big in China, right? And so after you begin to do well, pictures of what of your life begin to make their way back to China. And so people in your neighborhood are scratching their heads now. You know, we saw Joe, he left to go to some place in Africa, and we thought he was crazy, and now he's got a house with four floors and three cars and, you know, farmland or whatever. Like, what's good? And so the end of the result of this anecdote is that, and this is the human nature thing, is very few of us will concede that the next person's better than you, right? So if Joe can make it, I can make it too. Joe went to Africa. I'd never thought of going to Africa. I always thought Joe was an idiot. I thought he was an idiot when he said he was going to go to Africa. And now Joe has a house with three or four stories, and he's got three cars, and he's got land, and he's doing well, and he's got blah, 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 on and on. I'm going to Africa. And so this became the driver of the second wave. And these waves are not coterminous. They are sequential, but they're both continuous. This wave is continuing, and I think has become... There's no scientific proof of this. There's no great studies in terms of demographics or anything like that. But my anecdotal sense, having really looked at this hard, is that this second phenomenon is the bigger one, that it's the larger number of Chinese people in Africa in terms of the people who came post-1995 are these copycat people who saw that their neighbor Joe made it in this place they'd never heard of, and, well, if he can do it, I'm going to go there and try to do it too. I met, you know, time after time, met people who, you don't have to scratch, they offer up this story to you, right? and so this is how the people who are referred to in the title of my book, The Million Migrants, got to Africa. I say in the book this is a number that's taken on a life of its own, it's widely used, no one knows its origin. The Chinese state has never said how many Chinese people are in Africa. Africa has 54, 55 countries. They are not generally known for great bureaucratic acumen, and so there's no solid numbers for this thing. My own anecdotal sense, again, is that there are many more than 1 million Chinese people of recent provenance in Africa. That is probably my own guess. I would not be uncomfortable with 2 million as a guess, and that this is something that's going to continue to grow and is growing pretty fast. I want to say... I talked about historical mechanisms, and I gave away a little bit of what I had intended already. But so I spoke of mid-1990s and Jiang Zemin and going out and describing that Africa should be a priority area. And I just want to sort of try to shed a little bit of light on how the Chinese leadership could have come to a determination like this, and what it says about policy planning in China and what it says about the way we here in the United States see the world. The Chinese had, of course, at the end of the 1970s, begun a process of economic reform and opening. It begins very experimentally with special economic zones in places like Shenzhen and the like. And it's really timid at first. And this, I don't say that in a bad way. The Chinese leadership likes to experiment in ways that minimize risk, and it does so. This is typical, in fact, what they did with these special economic zones. Roll out a couple of them, put them in faraway places on the perimeter, see how it goes. If it goes well, then try to do something on a bigger scale like that. Learn the lessons and move forward. And so they have special economic zones. The first ones are practically hugging Hong Kong. And the money that they are drawing upon is Hong Kong money. So it's Chinese money from, you know, what are called overseas Chinese people in Hong Kong. These go well. So the Chinese say, well, we can do this on a slightly larger scale. And they begin to create more zones. And they begin then to look for other sources of money. And the next source of money is, well, so we know, you know, we're dealing with Chinese people in Hong Kong, that makes us comfortable. Next level, we'll find money from Taiwan Chinese people. And so they bring in Taiwan capital, and they expand these special economic zones. And now they're feeling pretty confident. This is growing pretty fast. It's doing pretty well. This can really work. Let's open it up and draw money from wherever. And so then investment starts coming from all over the place. The Chinese, so that begins at the very early 1980s, right? Toward the end of that decade, Chinese leadership begins a series of policy discussions, which says, in effect, and I'm going to do this really quickly and simplifying it, this has worked really well, this process that I've just described for us, but we're a country of 1.3 billion people, and special economic zones, as great as they are in terms of generators of profit and income, really can only marginally affect the lives of the bulk of our population. We need some other... We need to think in terms of subsequent phases in terms of economic policy and priorities, things that can really generate vastly larger sums for our people and can allow us to rise up what is called the value chain. And so the Chinese leadership begins to think that, well, so in the first 10, 12, 15 years of our opening up period, we have been the recipients, we have been the putty, if you will, of globalization as carried out by other people. The iPhone is a typical example. So the iPhone's actually put together in China, but where's the money made, really, from the iPhone? The money made from the iPhone is mostly made in California. The next most money made from the iPhone is in Japan. The third most money made from the iPhone is in Korea. You know, you don't get down to making a lot of money from the iPhone. I mean, for the Chinese who are actually building the thing are kind of down toward the bottom of the equation, right? So Chinese are thinking, we need to become the agents of globalization for ourselves. And that requires going out, prospecting markets, and being the actors, not being the putty. This presupposes a few things. One of them is... An important one is that we have to develop companies that can acquire global reputations, that can compete globally, brands that, you know, the thing I just described with the iPhone is actually the power of branding, brands that will allow us to capture much more of the value added in terms of the industrial processes that we're involved in. And so the Chinese leadership thinks about how this has happened historically. Two important examples come to mind, three actually, but to be quick, I'll do it in two examples. Japan in the end of the 1950s, early 1960s, did the exact same thing. They decided they Japan back then was stealing intellectual property and was, you know, the plaything of essentially American companies, Ford, GM, Xerox, GE, et cetera, Westinghouse. The Japanese decided they have to go out if they want to capture more of the value and have to create brands, and so they worked very hard to do this. Where the Japanese tried to do this was in the very teeth of the most competitive economic markets in the world. The Japanese went to the U.S. market and subsequently to the Western European market to establish their brands, which is a very expensive, very sort of risky and sort of long-winded exercise. The next example came, and so when I was in high school, and I'm dating myself, but you know, it was a joke to have a Japanese car. A few years later, it wasn't a joke anymore, right? And a few years after that, it was a joke to have an American car, right? So the Japanese proved that you could do this. The next thing you know, in the 1980s, some of you will remember this, a country that used to be called Yugoslavia decided it wanted to do this, okay? So we have to go out, we have to establish brands, we have to capture markets, we have to, you know, rise up the value chain. We have this clunky car, we're going to rebrand it, we're going to sell it in the United States. It was called the Yugo, right? The Yugo ended up dying, and so did Yugoslavia, right? Neither of them exist anymore. So the Chinese, I think, are looking, actually I've reported this a bit, and we'll write at some point more about this, but the Chinese studied all of this, and they said, you know, it's not because we understand that the richest markets in the world today cannot, if we wanted to make this work for ourselves, we can't avoid them. We have to try to succeed in the rich markets in the U.S., in Western Europe, in Japan, etc. But there are these, but we would be foolish to make that our only play. And that for certain industries, for certain companies, for certain sectors, it makes sense actually to find parts of the world where the competition is far less vigorous, where the entry costs are far lower, where essentially the big players who can possibly, you know, kick our behinds are simply not really paying attention or maybe not even present. And so this leads the Chinese leadership to thinking about Africa as a special economic realm, where for certain industries, the Chinese can come in at fairly low risk and at fairly low cost because it is a much less competitive terrain. They can gather experience, they can build brand equity, they can build markets for themselves. And so the markets, I'm going to wrap up, but the markets for themselves leads to the sort of final little piece of this. The Chinese understood in the 1980s what America is struggling to understand now, that Africa is a place that has markets, that Africans also consume, and would like to continue to consume. And they studied the demographics of the continent carefully, and they understood that Africa is the part of the world that will have an overwhelming percent of the globe of the marginal population increase for humanity for the rest of this century. In other words, most of the new people that are born in the world will be Africans for the rest of this century. Africa is 1.1 billion people today. Africa is supposed to be 2 billion people in 30 years. By the end of the century, Africa will be, depending on whether you take the median or the extreme case projections, 3 or 4 billion people. That's more than China and India combined. The Chinese are saying, we're not daunted by the fact that Africans have low purchasing power today. Everyone in China had low purchasing power not too long ago. This doesn't look strange to us at all. We see this as a place that is being completely ignored in terms of its potential, its commercial potential by the rest of the world, where if we set ourselves up and go for the long haul, our brands can build brand equity. We can, generations of Africans will grow up thinking of us and our companies as the go-to defaults. Just as, you know, from my generation, you know, buying something from Sony was a default. That was just an automatic good choice. You just knew if it was Sony, it was going to be okay, right? This is the sort of bigger backdrop against which this going out policy decision is takes place in the mid-1990s. It wasn't just a matter of sending construction companies to Africa to compete for business or a matter of, an outlet for Chinese population. It was thinking about, longer-term economic trends and thinking about competitive advantages and thinking about the competitive landscape. And so where do our maximum opportunities lie? And this is what led China to this strategic departure in the direction of Africa. And it's kind of funny to be speaking about this now, because the conversation about Africa today, meaning literally today, not in this era, but today, is dominated by the sort of thing that has been, it's kind of the ultimate example of the kind of general category of thought that has attached to Africa for Americans for a long time. We tend to think about Africa in terms of a small number of very powerful negative archetypes. It's a place of poverty, it's a place of disease, it's a place of unrest. And we as Americans, we have to be good people to those poor, unfortunate Africans and find ways to help them through our enlightened benevolence. There is a place for wanting to help people. I don't wish to suggest otherwise. But the Chinese have also demonstrated there's a place for self-interest. And that self-interest has payoffs, because Africans actually would like to be treated as people who have markets and who are economic creatures and who are worthy of consideration in the same terms that we would consider people anywhere else. So I think I'll stop there and maybe take a few questions.
Lots of food for thought. Thank you very much. I will not take the prerogative of the chair. I will open it up. Please be sure to identify yourself before you ask your question.
And please
start
make it
over
a question.
There. And make it a question, not a speech.
Earl Carr with Momentum Advisors. I lived in China for almost 7 years. I was curious, when you look at the development, particularly that you mentioned the infrastructure projects in Africa, what is your assessment of the quality, in particular the quality control of those infrastructure projects? Has there been a concern on that, and how do you think things perceive? In other countries, there's been a lot of concern about the quality of the various infrastructures. So, we appreciate your comments on that.
So, infrastructure quality is an issue in China itself, domestically in China. If you know China, it's hard to escape noticing that buildings very often, we're making very broad generalizations, right? But it's very common to see examples of buildings that are not very old that are deteriorating. They were very fancy and looked like it was like right up to the minute. Let's start at the beginning. They seem to rise out of nowhere, like bang. You wake up, there's a new building next door to you, right? And it looks perfect, like for about 15 minutes. And then next thing you know, it doesn't look perfect anymore, right? So the problem of quality in terms of infrastructure that Chinese contractors have faced is not unique to Africa. I mean, part of this is the fact of bringing Chinese practices of speed and cutting corners to a new environment. And the danger here is that I've spoken about African bureaucracies not having great acumen in terms of, data keeping and things like that. But these are not, China itself is a kind of spotty regulatory environment, right? African countries are, to speak very broadly, are even more sort of haphazard in terms of regulation. And so you have Chinese companies that come from a spotty regulatory, that have a spotty experience of regulation themselves back home, coming to countries that don't regulate very well themselves. And these deals that surrounding infrastructure creation are typically very opaque to begin with. And so, yes, often there are problems with infrastructure projects.
Carl Minsner, Fordham Law School. I was just going to ask the question about the long-term, what do you see as the long-term effects, both in China and Africa, of this human exchange back and forth? And maybe I was just to focus it on, by comparison to the West's long colonial engagement with Africa, that certainly has had impacts on African political or social institutions. It's had impacts in terms of population inside Western countries. It's maybe had a little bit less in terms of Western presence in outside of South Africa or settler countries in terms of long-term established Western populations, particularly after the independence movements in some countries.
Well, I take a little bit of difference with that in that Francophone Africa until the mid-1990s had very substantial long-term residents from, and I'm not talking about Maghreb countries, but sub-Saharan Francophone countries had. I spent many years in Ivory Coast. There were hundreds of thousands of French people living in Ivory Coast during my time there, and that was not exceptional. But you know, so China, a lot of people reduce this discussion of China-Africa to who's winning, who's losing, is China beating the West, is, you know, what's this going to do to Africa, et cetera, et cetera. And making this, and in doing so, make too quick a leap to saying that the incredible trade figures that China has racked up in a fairly short period of time with the African continent amount to, you know, I'm not personally very interested in the question of who's winning, who's losing, but I'm forced to speak to this sometimes. They make the leap that this means that China is winning. The fact that all of the recent infrastructure that's built in the given country is often Chinese built. They will take that and similarly leap to the conclusion that this means that China is winning. The problem with that perspective is that it's ahistorical. It omits consideration of all manner of things that happened before you, the observer, began to pay attention. And so the two most pertinent things that happened before, you know, this conversation about China-Africa became popular is that Africa was colonized by European countries. The cultural references of Africans are penetrated by the West to a degree that for someone who hasn't been to Africa, it's hard to imagine. I spent 3 months in Kenya this summer. You know, the middle class in Kenya is in some ways more Western than the people I teach in my school. I mean, they are completely penetrated by Western experiences. They, you know, have ways of speech that are totally up to the minute in terms of, you know, just ordinary kind of Western jargon, right? Slang. And this is a result of colonization and interpenetration in a cultural and economic sense that's taken place over a very long period of time. So all the new infrastructure in country X, Y, or Z may have been built by China, but all of the infrastructure before that was built typically by the colonizing power. Okay, so to say, oh, the Chinese built everything is to actually miss most of the picture. The Chinese built the new stuff, but before there was a new port, there were two or three old ports. And before there was this new highway, there were all those other highways, typically. Before there was, you get the point, right? So your question really is about the significance of the human movement, and I think this is where it enters. That by having this kind of human exchange, 1 million people, if I'm correct, probably closer to 2 million people, and growing fast. Chinese, you know, China can cough up 2 million people and they won't even be missed. It's like, and I don't mean to sound crass here, I mean, it won't make a perceptible impact on the on population levels in China, right? 2 million people is nothing, right? So you can imagine this going very far, and I think it will go very far. This, I can't really speak to China's ambition at a high policy level in this regard, but actually that's besides the point, because, you know, this movement of peoples is setting in place dynamics that are going to unfold really, really interestingly over the long term, over decades. And these dynamics begin to open up the cultural picture of Africa in ways that had never been imagined before. So you have, let's say, in Nigeria today, there's probably 150,000 Chinese people living there. There's Chinese TV shows on TV in Nigeria. There's an anecdote recounted in my Ghana chapter in my book that I witnessed myself, but a good friend of mine saw, where it was pouring rain one afternoon, and you know they have bus stops, and the people are coming out of the rain to stand under the bus stop, and a Chinese couple shows up, and the bus stop was already full. There was no more room under the shelter. The Chinese couple kind of edged their way in, and the Africans are grumbling. They're like, well, come on, we're getting this wet, and you know we can barely squeeze in here ourselves. And they're saying it to themselves. You know, Ghana has a universal African language called Twi, and so they're speaking in Twi to each other. But it turns out the Chinese understood Twi, and they said, and so they answered in Twi, what's the matter? Aren't we human beings too? And the Africans basically were completely bowled over, and it broke the ice and, you know, just changed the entire setting right away. But this is a little anecdote like this, I think, should open a keyhole for you in terms of the way that, you know, human contact works, and that, you know, the European Western monopoly in terms of, I mean, Africa is not just there to be shaped by outsiders by any means anyway, but the monopoly by, in terms of currents of cultural influence is over. And this huge movement of peoples is going to be important in ways that we can't even really begin to predict.
John Allen from Greater China Corporation. You read the press here that there's negative impact from the Chinese in Africa, but I'm not sure that's so true. Can you give us some examples of positive positions that some of Africa's leaders and people are taking toward the Chinese? Are there any initiatives, for example, of having some of the Africans go to China to study Chinese, or to reach out to China to have them come in and help build other than infrastructure?
There's this whole other thing that's taking place which I have not concerned myself with at all. I mean, when I was with the Times, I wrote about it, but I haven't looked at it since then, and it's grown since then. But in the city of Guangzhou, you have probably 100, 150,000 Africans living there now. And this is the other side of this coin, that there's no such thing as unidirectional population movements. Like, as soon as China discovers Africa, that means Africa discovers China. That's inevitable. That happened with Western imperialism too, that, you know, so the Westerners arrive in some place, and next thing you know, those people are back in the Westerners' place. This is happening very, very actively, and it's a problem for China, because China's never, has not recently, it's dangerous to say never for China, because China's a really long story. So in Song Dynasty, there was Arabs in Guangzhou, right, and fairly large numbers of them. But this has not happened in recent times in Africa and China. And so you have this big Africa thing happening in China right now, and how that plays out is equally uncertain, but it's important. The other piece of your question, though, you know, the Chinese government, the Chinese state, clearly sees Africa as a place where it can accumulate, acquire, and build soft power. Where it, the Chinese state, whatever it says, is competing for a variety of things. A convenient shorthand for what I think it's competing for is preeminence in the world. China is a civilization that's been around for a while and has had a good run for most of that time and thinks being number one is normal. And I don't blame them. That's fine. But for them, it's a natural, normal thing to want to be number one. And so part of that is competing in spaces that are, as I said, economically speaking, but it goes far beyond that, that they don't see as being adequately contended over. And Africa is one of those spaces. So China has this very broad policy of soft power that's based on creation of Confucian institutes, which exist in this country in many universities, but exists all around the world. China's investment in that in Africa is particularly great. China is investing in, because it has a handicap. Almost every African grows up with some degree of familiarity with the European language. Can you imagine what a handicap that is for a country like China that wants to be number one in the world? And this is not just Africa. Like, the whole world's like that. Every country pretty much has a European language. There are a few exceptions, but pretty much, right? And so China's investing in creating Confucius institutes that are trying to create Chinese language capacity all around the world. And it's doing this in gangbusters in Africa. China's creating, I think, with very limited success so far, but it's trying to kind of create news channels and newspapers and things like that to cater to Africans to compete with the West's models for these sorts of things, to win friends and influence people, to gain soft power, etc. The final thing that you asked about is, are they doing things other than infrastructure? You know, two things need to be said. So most of the Chinese people in Africa are no longer working for the state. They may have come there as construction workers for some state-owned company, but if they stayed there, they stayed there on their own. And now they're creating whatever they can think of to create. They're creating all kinds of stuff. You know, the whole range. What China doesn't do is what the West tends to do almost exclusively when it thinks of Africa, and that is, let's do some benevolent thing that we're, you know, going to help bring these poor people along. Let's create something for them and do it on a nonprofit basis and be out of the goodness of our hearts. Whether or not you believe that's what it's about, that's how we tend to talk about it or feel about it. China's not in that line of work. It shows no interest of wanting to be in that line of work.
Well, but you mentioned building hospitals.
Yes, and that's a soft power thing. You know, building a big state hospital, which is the example that you're talking about in my book, in Bamako, mm-hmm. Mali, is not actually a very effective way of impacting public health in a developing country. A big state hospital, believe it or not, has very little impact on public health. In developing countries, public health is really about primary health care, which means doctors who are giving, they're like generalists who are down at the local level of the population and they're giving preventive care and things like that. A big, visible hospital doesn't do that well. China built a big, visible hospital in Bamako, Mali, precisely, in my view, because it's a symbol. And it built it right at the edge of at the end of a big bridge that it built that everyone in Bamako crosses every day. That means that you can't get from one side of town to the other without seeing the symbol. Here's this thing called China-Africa Friendship. Oops, I mean a hospital. That's what that was about.
Are the African leaders reaching out to China? Are they saying, come into my country, we want you, we want to be partners? You see the reciprocity.
Sure. They want Chinese in Africa. So this is how it began in the first place. African countries, when China shows up in the mid-1990s, as a result of the Jiang Zemin decision that I described to you, this came, you know, at the end of the Cold War, end of the 80s, 1989, whatever, two things happen. The Western Europeans see the Berlin Wall fall, and they pull all of their energy out of Africa, the countries, the Western Europeans that had been colonizers. They completely gave up on Africa. They said, We have this captive internal market, European market called Eastern Europe, where you have highly trained, educated people on our doorstep who will work for a pittance. Let's invest in those markets. Let's build stuff there. Let's have our factories there. And the Americans went on a walkabout that continues to this day called fighting terror. We've been fighting wars ever since then, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, back to Iraq again. You know, in Syria now, it's been nonstop. The Americans, you know, I'm not questioning, that's for a different discussion, what the policy basis of these decisions was. You can make the argument. But what didn't happen is Westerners didn't pay attention to Africa. And the Chinese said, here's this place that's being ignored that has all of this potential, and if we just take the long view, we can do really well there. And they showed up knocking on the doors, and the Africans, because they had been so abandoned, actually, they were silly. You know, it's like if you've been starved, you were lost. You went on a hike and you got lost, right? And you ran out of water and food 3 days ago. And somebody shows up and they've got a thermos. You know, you're gonna drink it until you fall over, right? I mean, the Africans were like, somebody wants to invest here. Where do I sign? They didn't even read the small print. And they're just waking up from that moment now. Of saying, wait, look, the first round of deals that we made with the Chinese weren't necessarily the best terms for us. We weren't careful. We didn't ask enough questions. We didn't look at what happened in the neighboring country. We didn't, you know, we didn't have an open enough process or diligent enough process. Let's be more careful the second time around. What they're not saying is, and I really mean they're not saying, we don't want any more Chinese business. We don't want any more Chinese. Don't come here. You know, you might spoil us. They're not saying that. The Chinese have pockets full of money. And if they, you know, the Africans are, the conversation is, how do we get better terms? It's not about how to, you know, do we want them or not.
I spent a lot of time in Africa in the 60s writing.
Identify yourself, please.
Bill Bruce, I'm retired. But I worked in the battery business and there, Singapore plant. I spent a lot of time writing feasibility studies. Anyway, so I'm in Singapore and we supply mostly all the African companies with batteries. Shares varying by 80% in Kenya to as little as 5% in Nigeria. And we decided to put plants in some of these places. And so I got to know them very well. And going back to Kenya, I hadn't been there since in the 60s. I felt the quality of life has really sunk quite badly. The Kibera, the slum in the middle of Nairobi, was not there. Our plant in Nakuru, the government felt that they should own some of the plants, so they stole really very little money, 70% of the equity. The plant in Nigeria that I helped put up sank because the government didn't feel that they were getting enough taxes, and they doubled the import taxes. And the plant we put up in Abidjan closed because the French, we didn't let the French invest. So we had a lot of bad experiences there, not many of them caused by people in New York who had exalted opinions of themselves and not based on reality. But my real concern is that it seems to me that if you look at the population stats of West Africa now and Kenya, which like that has gone from 8 million in 1965 when I was there to now 40 million, it's a real problem. And it's hard to see how you're gonna really, they're going to make enough money to really pay for the things you think that the Chinese are going to do there. How do you feel about the population problem?
So, it's a complicated question. I think it's wrong to jump to the conclusion, and I'm not saying you are doing this, but some people do this, that Africa's population growth is necessarily a bad thing. Africa has had a very particular demographic history of vast depopulation as a result, or underpopulation as a result of a couple of things. The most important thing, which has to be cited first, is endemic disease. So humankind comes from Africa. And therefore, most human diseases also have their origin in Africa. And tropical disease in Africa has had a very powerful effect suppressing population in Africa. Chinese people arrive in African countries today. And one of the most common responses that I have heard from them is, there's no people here. Oh my God. I mean, they're applying a Chinese standard to the landscape. This place, it's empty. Like, get on the phone. Come on, guys. There's no people around here. I'm serious. They see the African landscape as being complete, as virtually empty, right? Listen to me. That is a result of primarily the suppression via endemic disease over many centuries. Secondarily, a result of the impact of the slave trades. I say trades plural because there were two major currents of slave trade, European and Arab slave trades. That is the secondary thing. So Africa is really only now, according to the most serious demographic work about the continent, entering the picture of where it might normally have been expected to be, demographically speaking. Africa at this moment is, according to the IMF, the fastest growing economic continent in the world. Growing faster than Asia. No, economic growth. Africa economic growth is faster than Asia's economic growth, according to the IMF. Africa.
I'm months ago, but OSID has said that a 600-kilometer, 10-mile ban from Accra to Benin City will be the biggest slum in the world by 2020. There'll be 60 million people living there.
So I happen to have written on this topic myself, and you can find my article in The Atlantic. Yeah. I don't take that view of things. Yes, it's going to become a mega city between actually Lagos and Abidjan, but there's no reason why, if Africa can sustain high economic growth, that it has to be a bad outcome. Africa's growing faster than Asia today. That's a fact. You cite OECD, I'm citing IMF to you. Africa. Well, so why is population bad if the economy is growing fast?
I think
you're wrong. So you cite a slum in Kenya called Kibera. I'm familiar with Kibera. But the standard of living is measurably better in Kenya today than it was a generation ago. Yes, there's a slum called Kibera, but the average lifespan of Kenyans is better. The average educational experience of Kenyans is better. The average income levels of Kenyans are better. That's a fact. Go to the World Bank page for Kenya and look at it. Compare now to 1980 to 1990. You'll see that's the truth. So yes, there is poverty in Kenya, and there's more poor people, not proportionately, but there's more poor people because the population increased. But because you're fixated on the slum called Kibera, you're missing the bigger picture, which is that income levels and educational attainment have grown in Kenya. Lifespan has increased in Kenya.
We have time for one more question.
I'm going to share it with you, but let me just finish this up. My name is Matthew Reese. I was working for the Times independently in the past. They didn't send me to China. They sent me to Queens, and they didn't send me to Africa. I went to Brooklyn. But it was generally business, small business economy. I continue to write about mostly Asia, but there's such a demand now for assisting people with east-west trade that we got to get our hands dirty in this sometimes. And one thing you mentioned that was very interesting is that China needs to do branding for their economic expansion. And I'm wondering, there are very few case studies of Chinese companies having great success in branding, at least that gets into the mainstream over here. Do you have any idea why branding doesn't seem to be something that has Chinese growth has taken advantage of?
Yes, because it has to do with the picture I tried to paint for you earlier of the Japanese and the Yugoslavs. So that, you know, a Chinese company that's entering this industrial landscape is facing companies typically that have, you know, in the best case, 20 years, like for Apple or Microsoft, 20 years of, you know, very successful experience, you know, and incredibly deep pockets. You know, in the worst of cases, companies like IBM or GE or GM, they've been around forever, right? And so here comes the Chinese company that's going to try to break into that landscape. I'm not saying they can't do it. Some of them will do it eventually. But that's an incredibly difficult thing to do, an incredibly costly thing to do. You know, it took the Japanese a long time to do that. And the Japanese did that under circumstances that may not be repeatable. And so this is why I think one among several reasons why I think China has looked to areas of the world like Africa to try to allow its companies to emerge, from which they can then sort of perhaps springboard into bigger, more complicated markets. And so you see, a company that's done very well is Huawei. Well, it's not Huawei. The telecommunications company, Huawei.
Okay.
So, Huawei.
Oh, okay, that one.
Yes. you know, it's not very well known outside of... So they're everywhere now, right? But Huawei was actually... It was one of these companies that really bet big on Africa very early on. Before Huawei was a very well-known name here, it had... it had begun to win African markets precisely for the reasons I've described. Let's get some international experience under our belt in a low-risk environment where we can win markets, and then we can then, you know. And so they have all, them and ZTE have all of the backbone of the internet and of cell phone stuff through in most African countries. And they're selling telephones that you won't find in this market there. There's Chinese cell phone companies that actually, that are doing huge business in Africa that you would you've never heard of before. And the whole point, and they're not trying to enter this market for the time being. And the whole point is that they're trying to get rich and to learn from their experience in these special competitive situations before they go the next step. It's not going to pan out for all of them, but that's a strategy that certain companies have adopted that seems smart to them.
Unfortunately, we have already gone over time, but as you can see, there are plenty of questions. Please join me in thanking Howard French for speaking with us today.
Thank you.
And there are books if you would like to buy some. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was great. And totally different from the book.
Was it really?
Completely.
Howard, I'm Lindsay Chow. I work for Old Remainder. We are actually helping some Chinese companies build.